Architects spend a lot of time feeling undervalued, pondering why we work the longest hours of any profession, and yet our wages are falling relative to others. And people don't trust us. We endlessly self-reflect on our irrelevance and impotence in the world of construction. I know because I do it too. Basically, we scapegoat our internal culture, our clients, project managers, our professional body, architectural education, anything we can, in vain hope that an adjustment within architecture itself can make things better. I believe this will not achieve anything. There seems to be little doubt that architecture needs to find a new valorization for itself within society, but I'm going to argue that its relevance will come from architects looking outwards and making a new contract with society. To do this, we need to find a new confidence and a new role, answering to genuine need in the interests of civic society and in the process of becoming repoliticized in the sense of working for people. At the same time, and in the face of increasing levels of regulation and the pull towards technocratic problem solving, it is essential to remember the poetry of architecture that can make the settings of our daily lives evocative and pleasurable. With the prevailing desire for economy and better value, this is the moment to be seeking resilient propositions that will be cherished into the future. Top-down approaches fail to understand the complex emotional, social, cultural, historical, technical, administrative, managerial, and economic imperatives that make cities work. In the current era, and in the wake of these failures, I would like to think that we understand the connections between society and architecture in a more subtle way, a perception that architecture's sole purpose is design, and that design is marginal to the key decisions in building, which are to say land values, land availability, lending, finance, and so forth. This has fueled architects' inability to influence the solutions that are on offer. But interestingly, what design does and can do is absolutely crucial. Good design helps life run more efficiently, and it understands functionality. So think of things like tube maps, trains running on time, IT systems working properly, BT line that doesn't get crossed. All these things are designed. Moreover, many aspects of design are highly rigorous, logical, and involve many, many hours of patient work. If we get it wrong, the stakes can be really high. And at its best, design can promote well-being, happiness, and delight, all of which make people feel better, learn more effectively, be more productive at work, feel in control, and stay balanced and healthy. It reflects back at us the way we think about ourselves and what we value. There is, though, a much more powerful process behind design, and that one is, and it's frequently thwarted in the desire in building to limit risk, control processes, and guarantee outcomes. Design works across boundaries, synthesizing information from a wide range of sources, analyzing it, prioritizing it, and bringing it together to propose an original insight that comments on and adds another layer to history, identity, ecology, of place. By its nature, it aims to be scavenging, disrespecting convention, in other words, disobedient. By making users the co-creators of work of architecture, we hand back power to its occupants, giving environments life, meaning, and relevance both in the here and now and in the future. We can only provide this by involving people in the dialogue, through participation in briefing, design, planning and feedback associated with each project. Common generic appointment and procurement procedures often work against this. So architects must step forward into the public stage to state how this process can happen. It means influencing all the other bits of the process by which buildings come about, enabling clients to work out what they want from the project, to develop briefs that balance communities' and landowners' interests, to influence procurement processes to better reflect the goals of the project, to engage the planning system in a narrative about quality and the idiosyncrasies of place, and to find the things people didn't know they wanted or needed in this new environment.
Why is it that architects would take on this role rather than, as it were, creating a new profession, or to say, well, actually the critical pivotal role here is around community engagement and community development, and the architect can be somebody in the team. But so much of what you've said is about community engagement. Shouldn't that be the person, those be the skills which are providing that kind of overseeing role?
Well, I mean, I think there is much, much more of that going on for architects at the moment anyway. And I mean, I think that Sheffield's sort of picking up on a way, but I think that's already, in a way, reflecting what's happening in architectural culture anyway. I mean, there's less and less work for architects. And what's happening is a redefinition of what the architect does, and this reconnection with communities and being community enablers and people who are beginning to forge what the agenda for briefs might be, I mean, maybe within or other organisations, maybe they're commercial organisations as well, is all part of that redefinition of what the role of the architect is. And in a way, I think my own role as the director of a small architectural practice is in a way on the way out. You know, I don't think there are going to be people like myself exist in the future. I think our role is going to be redefined.
And is it an ethical crisis as well? I mean, does it also go to the heart of the need for architects to have a code of honour, as it were, a behaviour, a set of guidelines, which would make it less likely that they would be willing to participate in schemes which don't adhere to the kinds of principles that you've outlined?
Well, I would hope so, but I mean, I think that's a very big ask, and I think, you know, there's always the issue about, you know, trying to make a living, and, you know, I think that's a very, very difficult chestnut. I mean, I would be quite critical of a lot of architecture that is produced in the UK because it's actually driven by money or, you know, it's by greed or whatever it is. And I think it is difficult to resist that, but I do think architects should resist it more.